Hi, my name is Dena Rock, and I'm very excited to have this opportunity to teach and learn with you about some issues relevant to Shavuot, and especially to be able to do it in honor of our very beloved Rav Shlomo Riskin, who is really a hero in my eyes, especially as somebody who both teaches at an Or Torah Stone institution and as someone who lives in Efrat, the community that he has really been instrumental in founding. So without further ado, let's begin. Our topic is tracing trends in Psak Halacha, and in particular, focusing on the issue of standing versus sitting for the Aseret HaDibrot. So to first even give some background, what I want to address is sort of this very fundamental question of how do poskim come to their decisions? Meaning they're faced with, say, the sugyot that they learn in the Gemara and with all of the different opinions that the Rishonim have. And also there's lots of other things that go into their decisions as well, like minhag and, you know, their own independent analysis and just all different, you know, what prior poskim have said. There's just all these different ingredients, so to speak, that get thrown into the mix. And largely there's this question of, so bottom line is there one set recipe that is kind of like, this is what a posek does when he's coming to his decision? And if there is such a set recipe, then why is it that so often poskim come to different decisions, right? If there's one set recipe, then they shall follow it and come to the same conclusion. Why is it that so often there's machloket, even among poskim, in terms of the practical bottom line of what should we be doing? And so again, we're going to look at the issue of standing versus sitting for the Aseret HaDibrot, meaning when they're read in shul, as an issue to sort of look at this through the prism. Meaning as the prism through which to look at this. But first, let me even begin by giving a little bit of background, which is that essentially, I would say, and first of all, to give credit, I listened to a shiur a few years ago by Rabbi Jonathan Ziering that really just blew my mind in terms of how to understand this whole issue. And since then, I just, everything that I see is almost like looked at through through the perspectives that I sort of learned from that. And so I've developed my own ideas also, but I do want to give him credit. A lot of this started from a shiur that I heard from him, again, from Rabbi Jonathan Ziering. Okay, so to start with, there's basically three critical ingredients that all poskim agree get thrown into the mix when you're baking the cake, so to speak, of trying to figure out how to paskin. However, poskim radically differ on what the ratios are of those different ingredients. So what do I mean? I mean that pretty much all poskim agree that when trying to figure out what the bottom line stock is, number one, you have to look at the Gemara sugya and analyze it and understand it and really, you know, delve into it. So number one is basically independent analysis of the sugya. That's sort of ingredient number one. Ingredient number two is that it's critical to also look at what prior poskim have said, meaning like anyone, whether it's a modern day posek or even somebody from the 1500s like Rav Yosef Cairo or the Rama or whatever, like they're not the first to address this issue. So you also want to see what have all the greats before you said, and that obviously is also going to impact what you think the final conclusion is, knowing what all the, you know, giants who came before you, what conclusions they reached about this issue. So that's sort of ingredient number two is prior poskim. And then ingredient number three is minhag, is just kind of looking around and seeing, well, what are the Jews around me doing? And interestingly, to those of us living in modern day times, we often have a tendency to kind of view minhag as like, well, it's just a minhag, and to kind of have a little bit of a tendency to, you know, discard it or disregard it, or at least not view it as something that would have significant halachic weight. However, as we'll see, there are many poskim, and many of them, the big name heavy hitter, so to speak, even to throw out one name, the Ramar of Moshe Israelis, who viewed minhag as one of the absolute determining ingredients in coming to decide what the bottom line psak halacha should be. And again, to you and me, we might think that that seems like silly, like, well, who cares what the people are doing? And maybe they're just doing it wrong. However, when we really think about what halacha is supposed to be, it actually makes a ton of sense to give halacha, to give minhag significant weight. Why? Because as we're aware, there's like the world of Torah Shebichtav, and then there's the world of Torah Sheba Al Peh. And Torah Sheba Al Peh means the oral law. It was something that was never meant to be written down. Halacha is supposed to be this living, breathing, vibrant, system that doesn't have a set written text, but that lives in the people. It's supposed to be oral. Like, human beings are supposed to be the repository of it. And therefore, put in that perspective, it makes a lot more sense for a posek to look at, well, what are the living, breathing embodiments of halacha? What are they doing that actually does hold a significant amount of weight in determining what the halacha is looking at what the people's practice is and say, if that's what the people are doing, and there's a mesorah for that, and there's a minhag of that, then that really carries a lot of halachic weight as well. So that's the third ingredient. Again, the three ingredients are independent analysis of the Gemara sugya, looking at what prior poskim have decided, and minhag. Okay, so those are the three ingredients. But as I said, there is a vast disparity in how much they weigh, each one of those ingredients. So for example, right, I would say the two big name poskim of the 1500s were Rav Yosef Cairo, who wrote the Shulchan Aruch, and Rav Moshe Isserles, who wrote the Mappah, right, who sort of inserted Ashkenaz Psak into the text of the Shulchan Aruch. Now, I don't know about you, but I know that growing up, what I was always taught is, why did the Rama do what he did? Why did he insert, say, his comments into the text of the Shulchan Aruch? That basically what he was trying to do was insert Ashkenaz Psak into this work that was written by a Sephardi posek. And that since Rav Yosef Cairo was Sephardi, you know, he therefore tended to, you know, Sephardi Psak. And therefore the Rama wanted to sort of balance it out and insert Ashkenaz Psak so that Ashkenazim would know, you know, what we should do. However, it's unbelievable that when looking at the introduction that Rav Moshe Isserles wrote in his Darchei Moshe, really in his commentary to the Torah, he makes clear that it is not just about inserting Ashkenaz Psak. Really, part of what he was doing when he inserted his notes in the Mappah was that he thought that Rav Yosef Cairo's fundamental recipe for coming to Psak was flawed, and so he wanted to sort of shift the weight of the ingredients. In particular, he talks extensively about minhag. So let me back up for a second and explain the way that Rav Yosef Cairo does, and then we'll really understand the Rama of Moshe Isserles much better. So for example, Rav Yosef Cairo tells us in his introduction what his exact recipe is for coming to Psak. What is it? It's that he's going to look at three poskim, three Rishonim who are poskim that came before him, and he's going to decide from the best of like two out of three will win. Who are the three he looks at? He tells us. He looks at the Rif, Rav Yitzchak Alfasi, okay, Rav Yitzchak Alfasi, the Rif, and he looks at the Rambam, right, who is super famous, right, Maimonides, and the Rush, okay, he looks at the Rif, the Rambam, and the Rush, those three Rishonim, and then he decides from, you know, whatever two out of the three say, that's how he paskins. Now, again, we're just kind of used to that, so we're like, at least I know I grew up, I knew that, right, Rif, Rambam, Rush, those are his big three, his Shlosha Amudei Hora'ah that he looks at. But actually, if you take a step back and think about it for a second, that's kind of a crazy recipe for Psak Halacha. Why? Because there's like tons and tons and tons of other poskim out there that he, and by the way, we know that he was aware of them. It wasn't that he was just trying to like give himself the easy way out by like limiting the pool he's going to look at, because in his Beit Yosef commentary on the tour, he quotes tons of Rishonim. But when it came to bottom line Psak Halacha, he tells us he ignores everybody else and looks at just those three, Rif, Rambam, Rush, two out of three, that's who he paskins by. And again, both, first of all, he's sort of like, you know, whittling out or like, you know, excluding from the world therefore of bottom line Psak Halacha, tons and tons of other Rishonim and Poskim. But what it also led to, therefore, is because of the Rif, Rambam, Rush, the first two are Sephardi and only the Rush was Ashkenaz. Of course, that meant that he tended to side with Sephardi Psak. He himself was coming from the world of Sfarad. Makes a lot of sense. But that's what he tells us. That's his recipe. Now, what's clear is that of these three things now that I mentioned, independent analysis of the Sugya, prior Poskim, and minhag, he is totally going with prior poskim. He's not really using his own independent analysis, nor is he looking at minhag. He is just looking at prior poskim. And even within looking at prior poskim, he's narrowing his field of vision and is only looking at a specific three from among the prior poskim. But he's almost entirely, again, obviously not completely entirely, but to a large degree is ignoring minhag, and even to a large degree is ignoring his own independent analysis of the sugya, which he clearly was capable of doing because he does it in the Beit Yosef. But in terms of bottom line Psak Halacha, Rif, Rambam, Rush, best of three, two out of three, and that's how he paskins. What the Rama writes in his introduction is part of why he felt the need to insert his notes is It's not just that he wanted to insert Ashkenaz Psak. It's that he fundamentally felt that Rav Yosef Cairo was completely off in only looking at prior poskim, forget even that he was narrowing his field of vision to just those three. He says, what about Minhag? What about Minhag? And the Rama says, Minhag needs and deserves to have a primary determining role in figuring out Psak Halacha. And Rav Yosef Cairo like belittled its role to like such a tiny little, you know, sideshow, so to speak. And really when the Rama was coming, inserting his comments, it's not just about adding Ashkenaz Psak. It was saying, I fundamentally disagree with the entire recipe that Rav Yosef Cairo was going with. And he really makes Minhag a massively more important ingredient in coming to Psak. Now, happens to be because he was living in the world of Ashkenaz. So then when he's going to prioritize the value and the weight given to Minhag, of course, he's valuing and prioritizing Ashkenaz Minhag, because that's the world he lived in. So when he's looking around at what the practice of the people around him are, it's Ashkenaz practice. And so again, yes, there does end up being this massive distinction between Rav Yosef Cairo representing the Sephardi world and the Rama representing the Ashkenaz world, but it's not just in terms of Psak. It's a much deeper and more fundamental difference, even about their entire recipe for coming to Psak, where again, Rav Yosef Cairo looks 90% at prior poskim, and even within prior poskim, Rif Rambam Rush. And the Rama saying no Minhag. And I'm telling you, I hope all of you are learners out there who continue to be involved in the world of learners and or go to Shirim or hear whatever. From now on, anytime you yourself look at a Rama or hear a Rama quoted in a Shir, pay attention. Almost every single one quotes Minhag. Constantly. He is constantly saying, Vinha Minhag Kapashud Hu. I'm telling you, again, I've been learning for many years, and until I heard this year from Rabbi Jonathan Ziering, I had never noticed that, how often the Rama is constantly quoting Minhag. It's not just about him inserting Ashkenaz Psak. It's about him saying Minhag needs to hold a more significant weight when determining Psak Halacha, and Rav Yosef Cairo, you ignored it way too much, and I view as my, you know, mission in life is to bring Minhag back into the world of determining practical, you know, Psak Halacha. Minhag needs to play a bigger role. Again, happens to be, he was living in the world of Ashkenaz. It's Ashkenaz Minhag that he's bringing in. But it's not just Ashkenaz Sfard. It's in general, what is your approach and your recipe for determining Psak Halacha? Rav Yosef Cairo champions prior poskim, and the Rama champions Minhag. Just as an interesting point of fact, there happened to have been a third gadol around their time, who just historically speaking became slightly less famous, which is the Maharshal. And he championed independent analysis of the sugyot. He radically opposed the entire enterprise of writing a book like the Shulchan Aruch at all, with or without the notes of the Rama. He opposed the notion of codifying halacha in this easy how-to handbook. Again, today might be the equivalent of the Pnine Halacha or the Art Scroll Halacha books. He was opposed to the entire enterprise because he thought, no, go back to the sugyas, crack your teeth over them, sit in the Beit Midrash, figure it out. There shouldn't be these easy go-to handbooks, regardless of whether they're prioritizing what prior poskim have said or whether they're prioritizing Minhag. He thinks the whole thing is like a wrong thing to be going about, and it should all be about independent analysis of the sugyot. So it's just cool to see that in the 1500s, the three great gedolim, Rav Yosef Cairo, the Ramar of Moshe Isserles, and the Maharshal, each championed a different one of the ingredients to be the primary thing, whether it's prior poskim or Minhag or independent analysis of the sugyot. Okay, that was just sort of to give some background. To jump ahead now to the issue that I want to look at, which is the issue of standing versus sitting for the Aseret HaDibrot. What's fascinating is that the two figureheads or dominant figures of Psak Halacha in recent times, in sort of for the world of Ashkenaz versus the world of Sfard, had radically different approaches also, not just to what the bottom line answer is of like, should you stand or sit for the Aseret HaDibrot, but they had radically different approaches to how to even arrive at Psak Halacha in any question. And the issue of standing versus sitting for the Aseret HaDibrot is just one of like, dozens and dozens and dozens of examples. Who am I talking about? Rav Moshe Feinstein, right? In sort of, the world of Ashkenaz, and Rav Ovadia Yosef in the world of Sfarad, right? We had these two towering figures, right? Again, we haven't really had that since then. These like just you know, across the board accepted Gedolim of, again, Rav Moshe Feinstein and Rav Avadji Yosef. And what's fascinating is that they were these, again, towering figures with like worldwide acceptance. Again, these two figures, right? Rav Moshe Feinstein for Ashkenaz, Rav Avadji Yosef for Sfarad. And yet they too had radically different approaches. It's not just that they came to different conclusions sometimes. Their entire approaches are so fundamentally different. What do I mean? It's really fascinating that Big Adol, and again, the standing versus sitting is a perfect example. Hold on, I'm going to do a screen share so for this that you can see the sources. Is take a look. Okay, we're again, I have earlier sources about the other issues, but here, if you look at, right, Rav Moshe Feinstein and Chacham Ovadia, right, Rav Ovadia Yosef, in dealing with this issue. So interestingly, on the question of should you stand or sit for the Aseret HaDibrot, both of them were asked this question. And I'll even tell you now already from the outset, they come to different conclusions. Rav Moshe Feinstein concludes you should stand, and therefore most of you listeners out there, if you're Ashkenaz, most likely you go to a shul where the people get up and stand when it's time for the Aseret HaDibrot. And Rav Avadji Yosef comes to the conclusion that you should sit. And therefore any Sephardi listeners out there, most likely you go to a shul where even when they get up to the Aseret HaDibrot in Kriyat HaTorah, they remain seated. But again, I'm not nearly as interested in the end bottom line. I mean, that's interesting and whatever, but it's how they come to that conclusion that fascinates me, which is that Rav Moshe Feinstein, if you take a look again, we don't have time to do it in depth inside, but look at what he does. He's asked the question about standing or sitting. He quotes this Gemara in Brachot. He quotes Rashi, right? He also then, if I remember correctly, quotes a Rambam. And then look at the critical thing that he does. Bisvara be'alma. Okay, and then he repeats again over here, bisvarot. Basically, he ends up saying through logic, you should be able to stand, meaning the challenge that's raised against standing, it might seem very intuitive. Of course we should stand. It's right, the Ten Commandments that God himself gave us. The reason that's given to challenge that is to say, well, if you stand for the Aseret HaDibrot, then it implies that they are in some way more important and more divine than the rest of the Torah. And that, oh, these parts were God-given, but the rest isn't. Meaning the problem with standing for the Aseret HaDibrot is what it implies about all the other parts of Torah that are not the Aseret HaDibrot that you're sitting for, seemingly therefore giving them less importance and perhaps less divine standing. And basically, Rav Moshe Feinstein, and he quotes a Gemara, he quotes a Rashi, and then he basically says that based on just logic, that problem shouldn't apply here, and people understand that this was given in Ma'amad Har Sinai, that was given by, you know, God in this, you know, unique revelation, but all the other mitzvot also were given by God, just not as part of this divine revelation, and therefore, b'svara ba'alma, by logic, you don't really have to worry that it's going to lead to this heretical belief that if we stand for the Aseret HaDibrot but sit for everything else, that people will then think that all the other parts that you're sitting for are not divine. B'svara ba'alma, he says that you don't really have to worry about it. People will understand. And therefore, simply by logic, it's fine to stand for the Aseret HaDibrot. And yes, we should stand to recognize, you know, the difference and to perhaps even reenact and relive Ma'amad Har Sinai. But again, b'svara ba'alma, by logic, you don't have to be worried about the fodder that this might give to heretics. And therefore, he supports the idea of, yes, standing for the Aseret HaDibrot. And again, when you look at this tshuva and you read it, it seems like, okay, I guess that's all there was to say about it. I guess there only was this Gemara in Brachot and this Rashi. Like that's it. That from sources, that's all he quotes. Okay. And then again, and then he jumps, you know, from bringing, you know, the Gemara and the Rashi, he jumps to his Svara. So again, if this was the only source that you were doing on the topic, you would think, I guess that's all that was written on this topic. Until you look at Rav Avadji Yosef, okay? Look at Rav Avadji Yosef's tshuva, okay? He wrote the Yechavadat. Again, this is Rav Avadji Yosef's tshuva on it. And again, he's asked the same question about standing versus sitting for the Aseret HaDibrot. The difference between the two tshuvot in terms of their approach, again, forget the bottom line. The bottom line is also different, but it's the approach that is so radically different that it's unbelievable. Look at who Rav Avadji Yosef quotes. He starts by quoting the same Gemara in Brachot, right, that Rav Moshe had quoted, and he quotes the same Rashi. Then he quotes Yerushalmi, and then a Shuvat HaRashba, and then a Shuvat HaRashba, and then the Tor, and then, right, he quotes the Beit Yosef, and, right, then he's bringing different logics, and then take a look what happens, right, and then here, I don't even think that Rav Moshe quoted the Rambam, it's here that, right, that Rav Avadji Yosef quotes the Rambam, And then he quotes the, right, that this, in the Miluim of the Rambam, and then the Mahari Kash in his, Shutim, and the Gaon Rabbi Shmuel Abuha, then his Shuvot, and the Chida, and the Mate Yehuda. I mean, the list goes on and on. Again, I only quoted half of them. All the things I underlined are different Svarim and Poskim that he is quoting in terms of citing what they said about this topic. Again, you cannot help but be struck by the radical difference in the way that they're approaching the question. Rav Moshe's asked the question, he quotes a Gemara, he quotes a Rashi, and then he brings his own logic of why he thinks it should be fine to stand that we don't have to worry about the heretics. The way that Rav Avad Yosef approaches it is not by bringing in his own logic. He approaches it by quoting a bajillion prior poskim. And what's, by the way, fascinating about this is he is fundamentally going back to the recipe of Rav Yosef Cairo, right? Who again is the chief Sephardi, you know, posek from like the 1500s, of looking at prior poskim, as opposed to, again, Rav Moshe, who's really using his own independent analysis of the sugya, like the Maharshal, interestingly. Again, not even like the Rama. Again, Rav Yosef Cairo championed prior poskim. The Rama championed minhag. The Maharshal championed independent analysis. Rav Moshe really is more like the Maharshal in terms of championing independent analysis. Rav Ovadia Yosef is going back to what Rav Yosef Cairo did, and he's basically, you know, championing and giving most heavy weight to prior poskim. But even though in that way he's like Rav Yosef Cairo in the sense of giving the most weight to prior poskim, but in a radically different way, because as we saw in the beginning, Rav Yosef Cairo narrows the field and only looks at three of the prior poskim: Rif, Rambam, Rush. Rav Ovadia Yosef is sort of using the same basic recipe of saying, I'm going to give most heavy weight to prior poskim, but in very stark contrast to Rav Yosef Cairo, who only looks at those three of Rif, Rambam, Rush. Rav Ovadia Yosef looks at everybody under the sun, people I've never even heard of, he quotes. And then he just sort of counts them up and goes by majority rules, which is, again, fascinating that even within the realm of saying, I'm going to give most heavy weight to prior poskim, he does it in a radically different way than Rav Yosef Cairo. Again, Rav Yosef Cairo looks at the prior poskim, but only three of them, Rif, Rambam, Rush. Rav Ovadia Yosef looks at prior poskim, but every single prior poskim who has ever lived, he looks at and then counts them up and says majority wins. To sum up what we have seen here, that again, I hope you appreciate, I think it's like so cool to like almost see the inner workings of the halachic system and how Psak works. What we have seen is how, again, when it comes to trying to determine Psak, that there's not, everybody is agreeing. So it might just then seem, what, then is it just a free-for-all and everybody's got their own recipe? So it's not that way. Meaning, as I said at the outset, everybody's agreeing that the what matters is the Gemara Sugya, right? Independent analysis of the Gemara Sugya, prior, postgame, minhag. The difference is the weight, the relative weight that's given to each one. And it's pretty amazing to see how, because of the different ratios of what they're putting into their cake, so to speak, what they think gets, you know, the more heavy weight, is it, again, Rav Yosef Cairo, who says prior, postgame, but narrows it to just Rif, Rambam, Rush. The Rama who says, minhag, bring back in minhag. Marshall says independent analysis. And then we see that play out in much more recent times with Rav Moshe Feinstein, who really gave very heavy weight to his own independent analysis. Again, we often think of him as probably being like, you know, very conservative with a small c, but he wasn't. He was a radical maverick thinker who really was willing to use his own logic to determine Psak Halacha. And then Rav Ovadia Yosef in the world of Sfarad, who really, again, goes back to like Rav Yosef Cairo using prior poskim, but not like Rav Yosef Cairo looking at every single posek under the sun. Okay, thank you for joining me. I hope that you've gained from our learning, and enjoy the rest of your learning.